Ilgaz Uluslararası Oda Müziği Festivali'nden hepinize merhabalar sevgili müzikseverler. Bugün dünyanın en iyi yaylı çalgılar dörtlüleri arasında gösterilen efsanevi Alban Berg Yaylı Çalgılar Dörtlüsü'nün kurucu üyesi ve keman sanatçısı Günter Pihler'le birlikteyiz. Welcome Mr. Pihler.
Welcome to you.
How are you? How are you feeling?
My feeling is excellent, thank you. Couldn't be better. It's still a little cool outside, but I have a wonderful garden and I have time to walk in the woods, in the Vienna woods, which are next door to me. And I am busy, but not too busy as I was for many, many years in my life. It's a fantastic end of my life.
How do you spend your time?
We are in Austria, in Vienna, and most of the time I'm in my country house, which is a little south of Vienna. I have time enough to read much more than, I mean, we had time to read when we were on travel in the airplane or in the trains, but it's much more time now. And I think it's wonderful. I read nearly 100 books last year and makes me happy. And I walk every day with my dog. I just crossed a little street and I'm in the Vienna woods and I can walk there.
Sounds like a retirement plan.
I spent more time than you would think, maybe, to help young quartets. They have a lot of questions and they need help in, they ask about how to handle a record company, what should we do with our management, should we change, should we stay? We have difficulties within the group, but would you suggest, you know us better, and things like this. And that takes a lot of time if you take it serious. And I love to do this, of course, to be helpful. I'm not really retired, no. And I think it's a great gift that I still can work and that young people trust me and that I see they have success and they can make a good living with quartet playing, which is much more difficult than it was in our time. It is a big challenge. You need a lot of idealism. It's always only a handful of really excellent, highest quality artists. You can see it, for instance, if you think about violinists, 5, 6, 7, not more, string quartets. It was in our time the Julias, the Amadeus, the Italiano, the Smetana, Janacek, maybe Lasalle, not more. Today we have also not more than a handful really top groups, but the rest is very good, and that's dangerous.
So, how did you come up with the idea of forming a string quartet?
I am coming from a very little town in Tirol, in Austria. I was 15 when I arrived in Vienna, innocent completely, but I discovered that it is important to go to concerts. So I bought tickets to every concert, opera concerts, and also I had an abonnement for 2 chamber music cycles. I fell immediately in love in the quartet literature. Of course, it was a long way because I had first to study, then I was 4 years concertmaster in Vienna orchestras, the second time selected by Mr. von Karajan, which was a big honor for me, and playing in such a wonderful orchestra in such a high position. It was very, very helpful for me to learn a lot, but I found out that's nothing for me for my whole life. And I decided to try to found a quartet, which was difficult because the tradition in Vienna was that the quartets came from the orchestras, and there was no professional quartet except the Kolisch quartet. So it was difficult to find people which were willing to take the risk only concentrating on quartet. It took me exactly 7 years to find the right persons. And finally, then we studied very intensely for 1 year and started then immediately our career, which was fortunately successful.
So actually, it was your idea to start this quartet.
It was my idea, and I invested all my intensity, my power, my strength to convince people to do this. I mean, it took time. My first, second violin was studying with me. We were good friends. My viola player was also a very good friend of mine. And the cellist came just from Paris, studied there, and didn't know exactly what to do. So finally, it was easy to bring all together.
How did you stay together for so long?
We were friends, we were good friends, but the most important thing is that you are friends, or you can really good working, you can work in friendship together. More important even, or the same importance, is that you are excellent professionals. If not, the friendship doesn't help. And if you do not like each other, it's also not possible, I think, to make music together on stage or doing the rehearsals in a good atmosphere.
Of course, it's very understandable. And speaking about the rehearsals, what was the general manner in the rehearsals between such excellent musicians? And how did you stay so long together?
We discovered after the first year, we were lucky enough to have immediately a cycle in Vienna Concerthaus of 5 concerts. That was easy to handle because we had 1 year before to prepare the repertoire. Then we discovered we are too slow to prepare 15 new pieces for a new season. It took us at this time 8 rehearsals average for a new piece, and that would have come to 120 rehearsals, 4 months, so that we said this is impossible. So we decided everybody should come to a rehearsal extremely well prepared, knowing what he is able to do or what is not possible. So we set up certain rules. For instance, somebody could play a passage which was not perfect 3 times. If it didn't work 3 times, we said, okay, do it alone. Intonation was not a problem. If everybody plays in tune, you have to do something in the quartet to make it really fantastic sounding, but it becomes easy. Playing together was not really a problem, because when it became to difficult places, we decided to play by memory so we could concentrate on each other. So it was a lot of discipline. And of course, the main question was how to approach a new quartet. And we avoided to have too many discussions. I learned this in the orchestra. That was one thing I learned. A conductor in front of a 100-man orchestra, like in Salome, for instance, there is no time to discuss. He must make decisions, and clear decisions, and to explain everything very simple and clear. And that we transferred to the quartet. And I am teaching now since 1992, I think, string quartets, I discovered that the young quartets are discussing much too much. They use much too much time to, you know.
Losing time, of course, must be avoided. But how did you manage when you had total opposite ideas?
Of course, there were fights. You have to learn to fight. There's not every day is sunshine, but it is also an art. The fighting can be an art in itself, and of course we fight it. The most fights were between first and second violin, and it is important overall to solve the problems that 4 personalities meet which are fitting together. 4 fighters wouldn't be together for a long time. 4 people which cannot make decisions cannot be together for a long time. So we had an ideal mixture of characters. I just was looking for a paper which the Borodin Quartet gave me the other day. You know, when I don't know if it's interesting for you, they founded 1947. And they set up rules from the beginning on. I translated about number 1, the present formation is definitive and cannot be changed, which did not happen. 2, string quartet is our main duty. 3, all the quartet members are equal in rights. Mm-hmm. 47, any problem must be resolved by the 4 members. Mm-hmm. Number 5, until the anonymity is not reached, the problem is not solved. Okay. Then number six, 3 hours rehearsal every day.
3 hours.
Rehearsal every day. Planning the repertoire for the rehearsals at least one day before. And then the last, any conversation that is has nothing to do with the quartet is strictly forbidden. Isn't that nice?
It's wonderful, really. Maybe setting up this type of rules made life easier for them.
Yes, more or less. We also set up rules like if one is saying finish the conversation or finish the discussion, it has to be finished. Everybody was allowed, as I told you already, to play a difficult place 3 times, not more, because if it doesn't work 3 times, it's not ready for a quartet rehearsal. Yes, we had not every day rehearsals because we were teaching also, but 5 rehearsals a week and 3 to 4 hours. And absolutely disciplined in timing. Everybody had to be in time. Nobody was allowed to be delayed. And except the second violin, no, he was in danger with his health. But even then, we played concerts and we tried not to cancel. We canceled in nearly 40 years one concert because a serious infection of our second violinist. That was all. Nobody was always in best health, but you know, if we are 4 people, you are 4 people, then if somebody is not really well and you cancel the rehearsal or concerts, it becomes a problem. So yeah, the discipline and being reliable is very, very important.
With rules you set for quartet made it easier for quartet, but how did you manage with your private lives while you were having such intense work life?
We had help of our wives. I was very lucky. My wife played the piano wonderfully, but and was a medical doctor, but she did not use the profession and educated the children more or less alone. We had an understanding of, you need the understanding of your partner and of your children, of course. They have to have respect, they have to like what you do, and you can guide them to love music. It makes it easier, but it's, of course, it's not so easy. In these days, you know, it was 1970 when they founded the quartet. Time was different 50 years ago. Today, young people are much more connected with family and fathers with children, and it was a little different at this time. And all the wives are working, it's necessary also. So it's becoming much more difficult for the young artists.
What would you advise to young musicians who desire to play chamber music and have such fantastic career like you had?
My advice, you need a lot of discipline. You need a lot of power. You need to be excellent professional on the instrumentalist. So you do not need too much time to learn a new work. You should, the planning your day, you know, it's not so difficult. Children are at school or study. If you use the morning for practicing, which we did, if you use the afternoon for the rehearsals, you have enough time in the evening for family and to relax. And my advice also would be, do not play too many concerts. We never played more than 80 and later only 60 or 50 concerts in the season, which gives you enough freedom to relax and to study and to be with, have a private life. This is, of course, important.
Speaking of young musicians, do you teach and did you start playing chamber music?
Yes, when we finished the quartet, which was easier than I thought, our cellist didn't want to continue because we continued after the death of our viola player, which was a tragedy, but he thought it's not the same as before, so let's stop. And I didn't want to change a member. I wanted to play, still to play, but without my cellist, I didn't think it was made sense. So we stopped, and it was a chapter finished, and as I said, easier than I thought. And then from then on, I did not play nothing anymore. I thought I had friends like Lisa Leonskaya or Anders Schiff or Heinrich Schiff that said, let's play together trio or some literature. I said, no, I don't want to do it, because people would say, then he should play string quartet. That's what he is really to do, able to do in an excellent way. I don't miss it. And I love to teach, not too much. I was teaching 40 years the violin in Vienna, and then together with my colleagues, in addition in the Cologne Hochschule, as successors of the Amadeus Quartet. And now I am for 12 years in Madrid, which is ideal because I'm there every month for 1 week, very intense week, and young quartets are coming from all over the world, and we have a fantastic working together. And for an old man like me, it is wonderful to play, to work with young, talented people. You feel as young as they are.
Before we finish our interview, I would also like to hear a little bit about one of your iconic recordings of Schubert, Death and the Maiden.
This Death and the Maiden was a highlight of our career, I must say, because the famous Russian-French-Jewish regisseur Bruno Mont-Saint-Jean, who was working together with Glenn Gould also. So he asked me one day, he said, I want to make a film with you, with the Maiden. And that was a big challenge for us. And he said, you know, when I'm filming, that's too complicated. You have to play back. And you have a wonderful recording of Death and the Maiden, and we do it with this recording. So I listened to the recording and I said, no, this is not what we wanted. And I remember that our producer said to me after a concert in Vienna, where we recorded the Janacek Intimate Letters, and after the intermission we played Death and the Maiden. And the company was only allowed to record Intimate Letters, Janacek. And of course, we were relieved that so it's behind us now. And after the intermission, we have done the Maiden. That's so we were completely free and played a good concert. And our producer said, Günther, listen to this. I was not allowed to record it, but I did it. I give you the material to you because I think it was very good. I did not listen to this. You know, you don't like to listen to your own recordings and playings. So, but when Bruno Mont-Saint-Jean asked us to do this Death and the Maiden movie video, I listened to it and I found out it's much better than the studio. So what you hear and in this recording, in this video, is a live concert without any cut. There is no correction of a live concert. That is, I'm very proud about this because it's good music and it's also technically on a high, good standard.
Your interpretation is absolutely fantastic, of course, and the filmography behind it is also wonderful. It's actually watching like a movie of Death and the Maiden, not just listening to your music.
There is something about the Death and the Maiden that about young quartets today, they immediately start with pieces like this. We waited for Death and the Maiden, for instance, for 15 years. We said we are not ready for this great piece. Or late Beethoven. We started early and then we found out, no, that's not possible. We need time. Time is, if you use it in a good way, means quality. And that for quality, you need time. And the timing of rehearsals, for instance, if you are interested in this, I learned it by when I was concertmaster in the Vienna Philharmonic and Karajan was the director of the opera where the Philharmonic is playing also. So he had two styles of rehearsing, two different styles, which I transferred to the quartet. One was, for instance, we had the opera Pelléas et Mélisande by Debussy. He used 12 orchestra rehearsals. Can you imagine? 12 orchestra rehearsals with a world-class orchestra only for one opera. And it was a dream, of course, at the end, he said, my dear gentlemen, it is absolutely a dream for me now to conduct this opera with you and fantastic singers. This was one one kind of his rehearsals. The other was we had to play The Ring, five operas. He said, "Gentlemen, we at this time no ladies were in the orchestra. Gentlemen, we have you give me only 100 rehearsals a year, and we spent already too many for other projects. And I know you know The Ring very well. So we have one rehearsals for every Ring opera. You know The Ring operas like Walküre, 4 hours; Götterdämmerung, 5 hours; Siegfried, 5 hours." So he said, as I discovered that after the intermission you need always 10 minutes to be concentrated again, I suggest, if you agree, rehearsals of 2 hours without intermission. Of course, the orchestra was very happy, only 2 hours without intermission. So I thought, how can this be possible, you know, to rehearse Götterdämmerung, Siegfried, 5 hours opera in 2 hours? And that was, the fact was, he, for instance, Walküre, the overture, he said, "Gentlemen, you don't need the overture, you know this, but we need this place, 3 bars before F, we need 6 bars after G, we need this, we need this." He knew exactly what the orchestra needs. And then orchestra was, of course, highest concentration. And I remember that the first oboist once interrupted him and said, "Mr. von Karajan, could we start a little earlier?" Karajan said, "Yes, Mr. Meyerhofer, I know this is a very difficult oboe solo, but we are not interested in technical problems. You always say you are the best orchestra in the world, so let's go to music." So what I thought, how to transfer it to the quartet. So I decided that after every concert, even in the intermission of a concert, I wrote down which places we have to rehearse the next day for the next concert. So I had a complete perfect concert for the evening rehearsal. We did always evening rehearsals before every concert, 1.5 hour, just to go from one difficult place to the other one. And there we invented a very strict system of discipline.
Before we end our interview today, is there anything else you would like to add?
I wanted to say that I'm very, very happy and pleased to have met you, that a young, energetic man with fantastic ideas. And I wish you for your festival and for your life all the best. And maybe we can meet someday. If I'm living long enough.